So we've about 15, 20 minutes for questions, and I see three hands already, for questions and discussions. Would you please say, give your name, and if you're directing your question at any particular member of the panel, please say who it is. Paddy Smith.
Paddy Smith, Irish Times. Two quick questions, but the replies may not be as quick. There's been a lot of discussion by the Institute and by commentators on the challenges for the second treaty, particularly on the future of the relationship between Ireland and between Britain and the European Union. And that's a lot of talk, a lot of thinking has gone on. What I haven't seen is much discussion of the what might be called the divorce talks and the strategic issues for Ireland involved in the first set of talks, what Catherine called the Article 50 talks. And I just wondered if the panel would reflect on what might be the key strategic issues for us. Secondly, I got a memo yesterday from an old Brussels hand who was talking about the danger of two referendums in Ireland to approve the final deal. Now, my reading of the Constitution is that a referendum wouldn't be necessary because there are not new competences being created. But I wondered if the committee or the panel have thoughts about the danger that we might be plunged into a referendum process.
Catherine, would you like to?
Okay. I think on the first question, the detail about the divorce settlement or the Article 50 detail, it's significantly less complicated following yesterday's speech. Because had Prime Minister May said we want to remain in the customs union, that would have had to been set down, how that would work would have had to been set down in the Article 50 agreement. Now, the agreement can simply say the United Kingdom will no longer, after a transitional arrangement, the United Kingdom will no longer participate in the customs union or whatever. So, but there will be issues like how will borders function? How will the transitional arrangements be put in place until we get to negotiating the successor agreement? And then there are issues of financial liability. For example, just to pick on one, the UK has been co-financing lots of things. The UK is a member of the EIB. How will they disentangle themselves from that? Will they want to borrow in future from the EIB as other third countries do? So there needs to be provision for some of that. Some of it can be then referring to the next agreement, but there's a lot of disentangling to do in the Article 50. But it is facilitated by yesterday's rather stark choices, I think. I continue to believe the more difficult is having said we're out of this, out of that, out of the other. Is going to be the next agreement, which is then how much do they want to come back into or enjoy some of the benefits of membership. On the referendum, I may stand to be corrected, but you can never get away from the fact that even if you don't have to have a referendum, sometimes people propose them. But my understanding of the Article 50 agreement is that it will be just an agreement between the governments. It would not require a change in the treaty. And therefore would not automatically anyway trigger a referendum here, but that's my current understanding.
Brendan, would you have anything to add to that?
I think on the first part, the CAP, I think, must be the protection of it, must be the predominant issue, strategic issue for us. And secondly, I've been long of the opinion that it will lead to a referendum, if not two. I think it's unavoidable.
Thank you. Tom?
Thank you, Dolly. Tom Ferris, member of the Institute. Two points in relation to trade I'd like a reaction on. The first one is, and it hasn't really been recognised, it isn't just trade between Ireland and the United Kingdom. It is the traffics that go through the United Kingdom. And one statistic, the percentage of boxes that go through Northern Ireland is 20% more than on a natural trade basis one would expect. So there's a much more work needs to be done on direct routings. And in that context, my second point is, it is, and Catherine Day would know much more about this, but it is very interesting that quite separately from what's happening at the moment, prior to the Brexit vote, the Union Customs Code was actually agreed in the European Union and is being implemented. And that brings a whole new world of new technology. and with it, the fact that companies can register as authorised economic operators, so you can do your preparatory work. You can get across borders without being stopped. Thank you.
Who'd like to have a go? John?
Just on that point, it's a very interesting point. I heard somebody from one of the big motor, I think it was a German company, but it may have been a French company, I can't remember, on the BBC the other day, saying that in any one of their models, literally hundreds, maybe thousands of parts during the life of the construction, which takes place in different plants, crosses borders maybe half a dozen times. It's not as if you're sending a component from here to Britain to form part of some product. It forms part of something that then moves on to something else. In other words, the network of supply chains will cross endless numbers of borders, and any ambiguity about the customs regime that applies would lead to chaos.
Anybody else? Okay, this gentleman over here, the third row.
Thank you very much. Thomas Kluge, Deputy Ambassador for the Netherlands. I have a question for Catherine Day. You're mentioning the future relationship of the Ireland with the European Union. And you said when the UK has left that the European relations will be more continental and less to the taste of Ireland. Could you elaborate a little bit on that?
I think that it has suited Ireland to be one of the countries supporting one of the big member states, the UK, pushing for reform, for openness, maybe for slower integration in certain areas. And I think it will be much more difficult now. We will go back to a more traditional Franco-German view of what the European Union will be. And it will require much more networking among all the other smaller member states if they don't like that direction or if they want to influence it. That's really the point I'm making. And I think when we get through some of the negotiating, and even long before we finish it, you will start to see new white papers, plans for the next stages of European integration, both because the euro needs to integrate further, it can't really stay exactly where it is now, but that also brings a lot of pressures for political integration. And I think the kind of debates I've been able to sit in the last 10 years will be very different without the UK participation. I think it's just a reality.
Thank you, Catherine. Gentleman down here at the very back. Yes?
Don't rather can't remember the institute. I want to follow up something that I think Brendan said. I may have misunderstood. He referred to when Ireland joined the ERM and that the French and the Germans made a loan to Ireland to help it adapt to this new currency arrangement, and then that translated into the cohesion funds. How realistic is that as an assumption of something that might happen, given what Dáithí said about Ireland being the most successful country in the last 40 years in terms of economic growth and development? And question then, if I understood what Brendan said correctly, question for Catherine, how seriously will anybody in the EU, the other member states, take Ireland's claim for yet more begging bowl type of stuff, which was the kind of thing that we used to get used to, we used to have when referendums were held here, that we had to be bought off? I suggest, am I correct in this, that there'll be no buying us off this time?
Thank you, Brendan, and then Catherine.
Well, you heard me correctly. But I only believe in the begging bowl when you have to beg. And I think we have to beg. But I've said in the annual report of the Institute that was published that we're looking for solidarity. We've got to remember it's a two-way street, and we've got to express solidarity. And then we've got to do what Catherine was talking about earlier. We've got to grasp some very tricky nettles here, particularly on common security. So these are the big issues that lie ahead. As to whether or not we get it, I would think the chances are very high, because we are suffering an asymmetric shock that's completely disproportionate to any other economy.
Thank you. Catherine?
Well, I think I learned last year that it's dangerous to make predictions, because who knows what the world will do. But I think it will be harder to make a special case now, because you have to remember that we would be making the pitch for a special case at the same time as the EU budget shrinks by nearly 20%. Yeah. So who is going to want to pay more for us? Now, we have always benefited from the fact that we're small, and so the actual cost of helping us isn't enormous in the wider scheme of things. But I do think you have to help yourself if you want to make a case to be helped. And I think we need to be changing things now, looking at trade diversification now. We're going to have several years before the real impact takes place. I know uncertainty plays a role now, but the real change isn't going to happen for several years. And we have to show that we have started now diversifying our trade, looking for new outlets. I think coming back and spending a lot more time in Ireland now after so many years in Brussels, I'm very struck by just how much we're focused on the English-speaking world. And I think we are going to have to discover, again, the rest of the European Union and maybe diversify more into that market and other markets. The EU is negotiating a lot of preferential free trade agreements around the world. We maybe will have to go further, invest in different kind of countries, but I think the days of our depending on the English-speaking world are coming to an end, or at least reducing in terms of importance. And I think the more that we show that we've done everything to help ourselves, and then if there's a gap that needs to be filled in, well then perhaps we can turn to the others and say, you know, we'd be glad for a little bit of help here and there, because we are a committed European, and because we are going to be part of the future architecture in a different way than what we were for the first 40 plus years of our membership.
Thank you, Catherine. We're running out of time. I'm going to take a question here just in the front seat, and then Paul Gillespie, and if I can take others, I will do so. Very, very quick, please.
Ronan Tynan. Everything I think that can be said has been said at this stage, but there is just one positive point I must put to the panel, and that's the whole question of the opportunities that must exist. I heard the chief executive of Lloyd's Insurance Market, just almost as a matter of fact, say, well, since 5% of the business, it is essential that it be based within the EU if the UK leaves. It's such an institution in Britain, you'd make that kind of comment just automatically. Given the length of time that business has to adjust, and the fact that May's speech produced, and the quote was, the word was, alarm among certain business groups, surely there is a tremendous opportunity for Ireland in that context, and we really have to factor it in. There is going to be no free rides on this occasion. The begging bowl is not going to work like it is, but this is a huge opportunity. But I would also say to Brendan, perhaps, that in seeking funding, and we must recognise it costs money, you need working capital to build infrastructure to capitalise on that real opportunity. And May's big mistake yesterday was to threaten the European Union, because that sends a clear signal to British business, this is going to be a long, fraught process, so cover your bets, and they will. Thank you.
Thank you, Ronan. I'll take the girl here in the second seat. You were looking for it, and then Paul Gillespie. Thank you, Ronan.
Hi, I just wanted to ask, in Theresa May's speech,
she
mentioned a bit about strengthening the UK and using kind of Scotland and the other devolved bodies. And you touched upon that in when they would get more the power back to the UK, how that would be distributed. But do you think it could lead to the unravelling of the UK, or is it a possibility of strengthening? Obviously, it's speculation, but...
John?
Nothing would surprise me any longer about anything, really. But look, no. The Scottish thing hangs on something of a cliff edge anyway. I think that in the short run there won't be a second referendum, but if this process goes AWOL, off track, that will certainly revive. And once that happens, then I think the entire settlement is called into question. But independently of that, don't underestimate the extraordinary phenomenon that why all of this is happening. We used to speak about a federal Europe. There are developments towards a federal Britain happening far further than merely devolved powers to the regions of the type we've been hearing about. It's a strange anomaly, but a fact.
Thank you, John. Paul?
I wonder what the speakers would think of the scope for special deals north and south to examine Irish interests and the common interest north and south within the negotiation, and also east-west between Britain and Ireland, a bilateral deal which has been flagged by a number of people, which could of course be stitched into the process. But is that something that initiative should be taken on in both perspectives?
Catherine, would you like to?
Well, as I said, I think other member states will watch very carefully any knock-on effects of a special deal between the two islands. But in any negotiating process, it is helpful to bring a solution rather than a problem. And I think anything that the British and Irish and the devolved governments can do to understanding very clearly the EU rules bring solutions, I think that the negotiators would be happy at least to give them serious consideration. So I think that's worth investing in, the same as I think it's worth us working with other member states, at least on areas where our interests converge. Negotiating with 27, 28 is very difficult, and you often see now in negotiations groups of like-minded countries get together and push forward a position saying this represents 9 of us or 11 of us or whatever. So there is room for all of that, and that's why I think there isn't a moment to lose. We have to do it now, and the more constructively within the framework we can come with solutions, the more likely they are to be taken up.
Thank you, Catherine. Alan?
Alan Jukes, 2 points briefly. We have a particular history about referendums here, but is it really conceivable that we would face a referendum, one of the outcomes of which might be that we would say, no, the UK cannot leave, or we don't agree with the deal? I mean, let's have some sense. But the second point, Catherine spoke about parallel discussions. When we joined the EEC with the UK, we had a transition agreement which got us from where we were to being in. We should apply the same logic now to the UK to get from where they are now to where they'll be when they're out. And May's speech yesterday gave us the contours of that. So shouldn't we really be having, as Catherine says, parallel discussions? Okay, one result has to be put on ice until the Article 50 thing is finished, and do the process cleanly rather than try to have two negotiations or two negotiations one after the other. It seems to be that that would compress the process. It doesn't make the problems any easier to deal with, but at least it doesn't draw out the agony for as long as the more formal approach would.
Thank you, Alan. Catherine?
Well, I think what in practice you will see is something like a heads of agreement, or maybe a bit more developed than that, for the second agreement, because it will not be physically possible to write all the detail of exactly how 25-digit NACE category whatever will function on from the 1st of January of whatever year. But heads of agreement about what the customs cooperation would be, how movement would operate, what kind of exceptions there would be here and there, a lot of that can be sketched out in more than headline terms. And that then will also be the negotiating directives for the second agreement. And I think those two will go in parallel. But legally speaking, you can't conclude the two together. And just physically, given the amount of work that has to be done, it wouldn't be possible anyway. But that we would have a lot of clarity on how things are going to work by the time we get to the end of the two-year negotiating process.
Thank you. Gentleman here in the front.
Thank you. Brian Daly from KPMG and a member of the Institute. Two questions, if I might. John alluded to the NATO point, and I thought reading Prime Minister May's speech yesterday that there was an implicit threat almost, as well as on the economic model, but also about the contribution the UK makes as one of the major armies in Europe, only two members with France and the UK being the nuclear powers and permanent members of the Security Council and so on. Could you see a renegotiation of the NATO budget overlapping into a discussion on the budgetary cost of leading the EU in light of the driven US kind of renegotiation, which they seem to be pushing it as a cost-driven factor as well? And secondly, there was a point made in Prime Minister's speech about the request for an early resolution of clarity for people who are EU people in the UK and UK people in Europe, which I think seems to be one of their weaker points, given that returning retirees to the UK in exchange for migrating workers back out of the UK to Europe probably is their weaker. Could you see any early movement on that being promised or delivered by the European Union? And maybe that second question might be more to Catherine.
John?
Your question, I think, touches on a very big issue we haven't time to go into, but that the European Union has even bigger challenges than the British one facing it, and one of them is on security and defence and all of that in a world that is changing before our eyes. I was struck by the fact, a little taken by surprise, to be honest, at the ready agreement to give the European Union member states the authorization and eventually the capacity to build up its own military command centres, which has never hitherto existed. They've used or been lent, essentially, NATO command and control centres. Now, that's a reflection of something I think is bound to happen, but it does complicate the British position post-Brexit, if we are eventually post-Brexit, in as much as there is a general willingness, which may be accelerated under President Trump for different reasons, to transfer more responsibility in the direction of the European Union. And here will be Britain, that always wanted to play a major part in this area, suddenly outside where the action is happening, but never used to happen very much, rather than and in an organization where the action and the power centers may be moving.
Thank you, John. Catherine?
On the second point, I think it, my personal view is it will come down to the classic phrase of nothing is agreed till everything is agreed. And I haven't done the economics, but it's true that quite a substantial number of the British citizens living abroad are retired and therefore drawing from the economies of the host countries, whereas a substantial number of those who are in the UK are actively contributing to the UK economy. Now, I don't want to make too much of that, but I think why would there be... I can understand individual countries and perhaps individual people wanting to have an early settlement, and I certainly understand the concerns of both groups involved. But from the hard-headed negotiating position that I was talking about earlier, why would you give up any negotiating chip until you can see what you're going to get? If that will, in my view, everything will come together at the end, but not until then.
Thank you, Catherine. This will have to be the final question. I'm sorry.
Thank you. Just within...
Can you tell us who you are?
Sorry, Jim McGing, a member of the Institute, ex-EU official. We've been discussing largely process today, but behind it we've really seen the outline of four major political instabilities. There's what the US is going to do over the next few years, which is for the least uncertain, and that will affect us in the form of NATO. There's enormous instability in the UK, as John Palmer pointed out, even within the governing party. We've now got exactly the same level of instability in Northern Ireland on the question of devolved government. And it's also been pointed out that we have much the same sort of political instability within the Union in terms of, as Catherine said, we're going to have to move into some new form if we are to keep financial unification as we've had it over the last few years. My question really, to whichever member would like to tackle it, in the old days, one relied a little bit on process to drive the political initiative, in the sense that certain political initiatives clearly were procedurally impossible. But I wonder if that's true now. Can we, I suppose we have to keep moving with the process, but can we really count on this process to have the same effect as it would have had, as it has had over the last 40 odd years?
Who would like to respond? John?
Well, I have to be a bit indiscreet. I know I'm not meant to be indiscreet in this situation, but strictly coldly objective. But I think the European Union faces enormous challenges. The ensuring the survival and development of the single currency is a fact. And in my view, it will require a dramatic change in the nature of the fiscal policies that have been pursued to date. An enormous change. And that is not going to be determined in London or Dublin, or perhaps in Berlin. Then there is the whole question of a much bigger and more pervasive challenge, which is true of societies throughout the world, the loss of a sense of democratic legitimacy. The formal structures are there. The formal structures exist. Difficult to think that they could do a much better job, but there has to be some confrontation with the sense that people have, both at national and at European level, and in many countries outside the European Union, of people losing a sense of ownership of the political project. I know that begs an infinite many more questions that can be answered, but I think it is the one hanging over even the Brexit issue.
Anybody else like to say anything?
Well, okay. I might just say that I think Catherine made a very important contribution, what she said in our presentation, about thinking and thinking harder and accommodating to what's going to be a new EU. It is going to be a new EU, and it's almost going to be a reversion back to the original in the sense of a Franco-German alliance. Now, on the assumption that France remains ruled by the centre-left, and not by a Le Pen type of thing, which is always a possibility. But it therefore puts us in a situation where we've got to confront issues that we have not done in the past, for example, on taxation, on security, on whether or not we participate in the Schengen area, whether we really get involved in Frontex, whether we take some relationship with NATO. These are all issues we have postponed essentially for 40 years. I think now they're unavoidable. And I think that's the real agenda.
On that note, let me just remind you of what Brendan said earlier on, that there are contributions going up on the website of the Institute very regularly as the situation evolves. I think we should thank our four panelists for really a very, very stimulating discussion. Thank you very much.